أناجي الحق في ليل لهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى أناجي الحق في ليل لهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا بكم and welcome to another edition of Perspective. My name is Faizel Patel. In tonight's show, we look at a Palestinian baby that was sadly burned to death. Rameez Patel back in the spotlight and re-arrested. And we also look at some tech news. Remember, you can interact with me by sending me a mail on faizel@itvnetworks.tv. Drop me a tweet on @faizy143, or you can even comment on facebook.com/faizelpatel. Now, one of the biggest stories last week, and a very, very, very sad story, it touched a lot of people that I know. It might have even have touched you. A Palestinian baby was killed and three other members of his family critically injured after suspected Jewish extremists set two homes alight in the early hours of Friday morning in Duma, which is just south of Nablus, as a family slept inside. Imagine the horror. Imagine the fear of this raging fire as this family was sleeping inside. According to local residents, the parents woke up and tried to remove their children from the house, but were unable to save their youngest son. The other torched house was empty at the time, and fortunately so. Little Ali Saad Dawabshe, who was 18 months old, think about it, 18 months old, died from his wounds he sustained in the blaze. His father, his mother, and his four-year-old brother also sustained severe injuries and are currently being treated at the intensive care unit at a hospital in Nablus. Now, very ironic, the Israeli Defense Force, or IDF, as many of us know it, has condemned the attack and has heightened its efforts to locate those responsible for the terrorist attack. Now, just to carry on this particular story, and I want to digress a bit, prior to this incident, there was also an attack during a gay parade in Israel as well, where a Jewish extremist stabbed a few people with a knife in their backs in this particular parade. So this extremism is what the Israeli Defense Force is trying to combat. And obviously a lot of people has condemned this from the gay fraternity with regards to that particular incident. And obviously from the world with regards to this baby, an 18-month-old baby that has died. Now this particular attack against civilians is nothing short of barbaric. It's an act of terrorism. These are the exact quotes of Lieutenant Colonel Peter Lerner, and he's a spokesperson for the Israeli Defense Force. And he says a comprehensive investigation is underway in order to find the terrorists and bring them to justice. But think about it. I mean, it could be your child, anybody else's little child, 18 months old. He hasn't even lived his life. He hasn't even bloomed into the little boy or the happy little boy that's running around being naughty, and his life was so quickly snatched from him in this ruthful and in this revengeful manner by an extremist who knows what the investigations will transpire. Now, there are reports that the infamous price tag slogan typically used by radical Jewish settlers attacking Palestinian houses, as well as other sites like Christian churches, masajid, and government buildings, was daubed on the walls of the home, according to police spokesperson, and her name is Luba Simri. And if you watch TV stations like Al Jazeera, or if you've gone onto the internet, or even on social media like Twitter and Facebook, you would have seen the pictures of the home. It was absolutely devastating. That picture of the child just breaks your heart. And you can just imagine the fear. Again, I want to re-emphasize the fear Imagine the struggle to get out of this house when this house was actually caught alight. We can never, ever imagine what this parents might have gone through. And their youngest child had to die in such a bad manner. Let us make dua for this, for this child. And, let us make it easy for the family. They are being treated, and hopefully they can, make it out healthy from hospital, inshallah. Coming to another story that has made headlines. This is a story that I've covered on Perspective before. Rameez Patel, we know that he's a businessman from Polokwane. Well, Limpopo police have confirmed, I've spoken to them, they have confirmed that murder accused Rameez Patel has been rearrested. Now listen to this. This time for the alleged murder of another man in Polokwane 2 years ago in 2013. Now, a lot of you will know from my reports and from other media sites is that Patel was currently out on bail of about 250,000 rand for allegedly killing his wife Fatima at the Nirvana townhouse complex in April this year. Now, he has pleaded not guilty to the charges and he's adamant that Fatima was killed by robbers. And it's such a contentious issue at the moment, because there's even a Facebook page, and I'm not going to mention it, that actually labels so many accusations and so many allegations against Rameez, which is just speculation, but it's become an absolute farce of the accusations that's been labeled against this man. But he maintains that not guilty plea, that he didn't kill her. And obviously we're going to have to wait for the court to decide whether he's guilty or not. Now, the police's Ronel Otto, who I've spoken to, says Patel was arrested at his work on Friday last week. And she says the case relates to the murder of a man named Tony Adams, who lived in Westernburg and was killed in 2013, like I mentioned. Now, Otto says that Adams was assaulted. Now, this is the most brutal part. Otto says Adams was assaulted with a hockey stick after he allegedly broke into Patel's property. His body was found dumped at a supermarket parking lot in the area. Now, Patel appeared in court on Monday, and the case has been postponed to the 11th of this month for a formal bail application. Now, you must remember also, I did ask the police whether Tony Adams possibly, and I'm just using this word in a very light way, possibly or allegedly had a feud with Rameez Patel. Could that possibly have resulted in him allegedly beating Tony Adams to death? Or could it have been just a random housebreaking? And the police said that they couldn't reveal that information. It will compromise the investigation, and they are continuing to investigate. So we don't know what the circumstances of Tony Adams breaking into the property was, whether it was a feud with Rameez or not, or whether it was a random housebreaking. Now, last week, the police's Ronel Otto also confirmed that Fatima's body was exhumed for forensic tests. Now, I'm not going to go on to the exhumation of Islamic, whether it's correct or not. That's a different matter altogether. And then earlier this month, Rameez's bail conditions were amended by Magistrate Mohammed Sheikh. Remember, he could move around more freely in Polokwane. His children could be given passports as well to travel overseas. So, his conditions were relaxed. But now, Rameez, like I mentioned, has maintained his innocence, and he's adamant his wife was killed by robbers. And we're going to have to wait. You know, it's prudent to speculate. Let us wait and see when he does appear on the 11th for a formal bail application, what transpires. Meanwhile, the police say, and like again, I want to emphasize, the state will oppose the bail application when Rameez appears in the Polokwane Magistrates Court on a second murder charge. And Ronel Otto also says Patel's bail conditions will be reviewed when he appears in court on the 11th of August. And then she says that the forensic test conducted on Fatima's body after it was exhumed last week did not form part of the investigation that led to Patel's arrest last week, Friday. So it's going to be very, very difficult for him. A second murder charge. He was released on bail, 250,000 rand. We're going to keep you updated when he does appear on the 11th of August. Unfortunately, we're not going to be able to go to Polokwane. It's quite a distance to travel, but we do have our sources that gives us the information, and then we will bring that to our ITV viewers. We're going to go for a break. After the break, we're going to be speaking about another story that's been making headlines. Remember that in the papers last week, there were reports that President Jacob Zuma's wife actually poisoned him, and City Press has reported extensively on that, and that's the story we're going to be speaking about just after the break. Stay tuned to Perspective. Welcome back to Perspective. My name is Faizel Patel. City Press editor Faryal Effigy says she's standing by the story her paper printed claiming President Jacob Zuma's wife, Nompumelelo Ntuli Zuma, has admitted to being part of a plot to poison him. Ntuli Zuma's lawyer says the story is not true and say they are considering suing the paper for making defamatory claims. Now, the paper said a few days ago that she'd confessed to knowing about the plot to use her access to Zuma. But her attorney, Ulrich Ruh, says that the story is not true. They say it's fabricated, it's defamatory, it's filled with a whole lot of other lies, a whole lot of issues that goes with it. Now, he says there are no credible sources named. It raises the question why the newspaper would not rely on these sources and name them if they are confident that the information provided is accurate and correct. Now, Ruh also says that the story is a fabrication and is defamatory, like I mentioned just a few seconds ago. And then she is certainly considering all the various options. If we, this is now Ulrich Ruh saying, if we find that they are guilty of having reported negligently and recklessly, then we will advise our client accordingly. Now, the City Press reported that it had well-placed sources indicated that she would soon be charged with conspiracy to commit suicide. This is Ma Ntuli. Now, Ntuli Zuma was also apparently banned from the Nkandla homestead earlier this year following claims of a plot to poison the president. It is alleged and a docket was opened with the National Prosecuting Authority, or the NPA, with sources saying Ntuli Zuma made a statement to investigators. Now, the City Press reported that while sources in the NPA said that top bosses are aware of the matter, the spokesperson Vuyo Mfaku denied this categorically. An investigation is now underway to find out whether the NPA staff leaked the information about that particular probe. Now, Ntuli Zuma was first suspected when the president became ill in June 2014, which is last year. Now, Zuma was told that he had been poisoned by more than one doctor during his trip to the United States in August last year. So let me know what your thoughts and comments are. You know, the Zuma debacle just carries on and on. And to expound further on that, you must remember, at the moment, currently, as we speak, there is a bitter spat that's been going on between Ntuli Marunsela and President Jacob Zuma on this Nkandla issue. 246 million rand spent. Zuma, is lashed out at Ntuli Marunsela. He says she's undermining parliament. But I felt that this particular story was more important. It's just, this man is embroiled in controversy wherever he goes. And on social media, I mean, there's so many reports that criticizes him. So let's see how the story develops and as we go along as well. But if you haven't read the article, if you do happen to have a copy of the City Press, do read it and let me know what your thoughts and comments are. Moving on to the Western Cape. The Western Cape government is considering, and this is something that a lot of people have been speaking about as well, the government is considering developing a 1 billion rand halal agri-processing food park near the Cape Town International Airport or Cape Winelands in the Western Cape. Now, the proposed park, developed in conjunction with the Western Cape Fine Foods Initiative and the private sector, will be a cluster of manufacturing and service firms in the halal industry. Now, Alan Wendy, he's the Provincial Minister of Economic Opportunities. I did speak to him, and he said that the global halal market is worth about 2.3 trillion, and the proposed halal park will allow the Western Cape to double the share of that fast-growing market. And he says, to quote, "We seek to increase the value of halal exports by $31 billion by 2020. And this was revealed in a statement. Now, the target market will be the Middle East, North Africa, home to an estimated 20% of the world's Muslim population. And when you also envisage the proposed park could add about 5,000 new jobs to the economy in the next 5 years. Now, the park, if approved, could be launched in the next two years, obviously, if it is approved by Parliament. And he says, Wendy says, he will submit the proposal to Cabinet this month. So for those Cape Town viewers who are tuned in this evening, let me know about your thoughts and comments with regards to this park. You know, it's 5,000 jobs. Also a halal plant. We don't know what the sentiments or opinions or the comments are from the non-Muslim fraternity, but you can send me a tweet on Faizel143 or mail me on faizel@itvnetworks.tv or drop me a comment on facebook.com/Faizel Patel. Another of the stories that's been making headlines recently, and no doubt you'd have heard it on mainstream media, you'd have read it on social media or even in the papers, South African businessman and former politician Tokyo Sekwale says he's still consulting on whether to run for the FIFA presidency and is yet to make up his mind. So, Tokyo now deciding to run for FIFA presidency. Sepp Blatter, we know, is embroiled in a whole lot of corruption, and we're not going to focus on the FIFA story now at the moment, especially the corruption part. Sekwale has been approached to submit his name as a candidate for the football body's top post, and according to his spokesperson, by several highly placed people within the fraternity. Now, outgoing FIFA head Sepp Blatter announced that he would be stepping down in May, in light of one of the world's worst corruption scandals to hit the federation. Now, Sekwale's spokesperson, I've spoken to him, his name is Peter Paul Ngwenya, says that the former politician will announce his decision in due course in a formal press statement. And he says, to quote, he says that Sekwale is honored and humbled, so the fact that he is consulting means he wants to come to the right decision. Otherwise, he would have just said, no, I'm not interested. And he also told me that he doesn't want to attach his name if the body is going to be embroiled in such corruption. He wants to make sure and decide properly before he decides to go run for the presidency. Now, coming on to our tech segment, we used to speculation, starting in advance of releases, whether it's a smartphone or a notebook, or in my case, the latest iPad or latest iPhone or a tablet or any other tablet. But usually the details are sort of spottier at this stage with regards to a lot of other products. But what we're speaking about this evening is about LG's G Flex. Their new cell phone is about to get another sequel, and the specs for the wobbly handset are out and about already. So if you've seen it on social media and obviously tech websites as well. Now, the LG G Flex 3 will, according to an anonymous source, be scaling the spec sheet later when it launches early next year. Some of the specs, a 6-inch 2K display is on the cards, as well as a Snapdragon 820 processor, which should, if the handset launched today, put it right near the top of the charts in terms of power. Now, 4 gigs of RAM, 32 gigs of storage wouldn't hurt either. Two more specs are the rumored for the LG handset, which, I mean, these days we require a lot of space with photos, music, or whatever the case you have. A lot of apps also that people use. Now, the LG Flex 3 will also have a fingerprint scanner, like the iPhone or the iPad, a front-facing 8-megapixel camera, and a rear 20.7-megapixel camera, no doubt with LG's camera flourishes in place. Now, the LG G Flex 3 will apparently arrive in March 2016. This is according to the unnamed source. So there's still a lot of time for things to change, maybe additional features as well. As it stands now, this Flexi phone is sounding, well, pretty attractive. But I'm just worried because, you know, LG doesn't tend to hold that resale value as supposedly like in a Samsung or as an iPhone or maybe of the others, like maybe even a Sony. So let me know what your thoughts and comments are as well. And before we conclude the program this evening, we know that we are in the month of Shawwal. We just got 2 months left, a month left before we move on to the month of Zilhajjah. And we know that a lot of people that have been accredited are going to be, inshallah, embarking for the spiritual journey of Hajj. And what we're going to do on perspective, inshallah, is try to focus on the memories of the Hajj. So if you have been on Hajj, if you went to Hajj, no matter which year it was, whether it was the very early years or even last year or even whenever, send me your contributions, send me your reflections, send me your stories on Hajj on my email, which I'm going to give towards the end of the program, and let me know what was the most remarkable aspect of your journey. What was it like going to Makkah, Medina, performing Hajj, going to Arafah, going to Mina, going to Muzdalifah? What was the best time? You know, South Africa's quota only allows a certain amount of people to go for Hajj every year. And sometimes you might want to your heart desires and you can go for Umrah, but Hajj is a total different experience as well. So send me your recollections, send me your memories, send me your stories, and inshallah, we will read out some of that on air. We are coming to the dawn of Hajj. The month of Hajj, Dhul Hajjah, is coming in. Let us reflect on its stories. Let us make dua for the people that are going. Let us ask those people that are going for Hajj to make dua for us, inshallah. And we will then read out some of those stories. I really want to read your stories. It is such a nice time to reflect our heart desires to be there. Unfortunately, we've come to the end of another edition of Perspective for this week. Join me again next week, inshallah, when we again discuss stories making headlines locally, nationally, and internationally. Remember, you are welcome to interact with me by sending me a tweet on Faizy143. You can send me a mail, including those Hajj stories, on faizal@itvnetworks.tv, or drop me a comment on facebook.com/Faizel Patel. From myself, Faizel Patel, and the great team here at ITV, fi amanillah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أناجي الحق في ليل لهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى. أناجي الحق في ليل لهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى. إلهي صرت في ظرف عصيب فاكشف البلوى، فيا ربي أنا عبد لرد الطيم لا يقوى. أعني